Hello?
Hi.
Hey, what's up, buddy?
Not a whole lot. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. You can hear me just fine?
Yeah, your sound's good. What about me?
Yep, you sound perfect. Flawless.
Good. Okay. So I've just stumbled upon you, and you fascinate me, so I need to pick your brain a little bit.
Yeah, sure thing.
Let me see. Which one was it? I think it was the Sargon video, where you and Sargon talked. I think it was maybe like a week and a half, a week ago.
Yeah, I remember it.
I was just listening to it, and just how you're talking about women and portraying women. It was just it was taking me aback a little because I've never encountered these women that you're claiming that need all of this help.
Okay. Whew. All right. Let's back up a little bit, okay?
Yeah, so just tell me where you stand. Like, where are you coming from? Like, where's your line?
Yeah, I understand. We're basically having a conversation about agency, right? Would you agree with that?
Yeah.
Okay. So, real fast, I took a gander at your Twitter. It looks like you are and I'm guessing like an atheist or at least a religious.
I'm an anti-theist, but yeah, completely secular.
Okay, gotcha.
So I'm liberal.
Okay,
So
cool.
if you want to know where I stand.
Sure. Okay, so I'm just curious. In terms of are you familiar with like concepts like determinism or free will or anything like this?
Yeah.
Okay, do you believe are you like a big free will person or do you fall more on the deterministic side of things or?
When it comes to free will, I think we're kind of it is a little bit of our own. You're making your own decisions, but you are influenced by things in your environment and the activities you associate with and participate in. And but I kind of I'm on the side with Sam Harris that you don't really have as much free will as you think.
Sure. I would almost agree with that. I would even take it a step further, and I would be curious if you have any kind of I guess what you would think of this. Some people would argue that the choices that you make, if you could measure the precise activity in a person's brain, right? If you could measure all the activity in a person's brain, that you could basically determine any answer to any question you could give them or any behavior, right? If you could measure all of the neurons, all of the neurotransmitters, the total physical state of a person's brain, and then throw them in a certain environment, that you could figure out exactly how they would answer. Do you believe that or do you not believe that? It's kind of a loaded question, so.
Well, I think there's a possibility that you could do that. Like put someone under imaging and ask them questions, or put images in front of their eyes and things like that, and then track the neural pathways and things like that. I mean, I'm not educated on that a lot, but I can follow the conversation. So yeah,
I'm not even,
I'm
just to
sure it's a
clarify,
possibility. Yeah.
I understand with current technology, we absolutely could not do this. So I'm not saying that like right now that this is within the realm of science, right? I don't know if it will ever be there. But just basically the idea is you should be able to measure an entire person's brain and figure out what outputs you'll get based on the inputs. If you put them in a certain environment, ask them a certain question, you know, figure out how they'll respond, right? If you don't believe that, then the follow-up question is, where else does a person get the ability to make decisions? Because at that point, you're almost kind of like metaphysical at that point, right? You're outside of the realm of what can be measured. And then for spirituality,
Right.
it's very easy. If you're religious, you can answer questions, you know, in regards to the soul or God or whatever. But if you're an atheist, it's a little bit tougher there, right? Would you agree with that?
Absolutely, yeah.
Okay, cool. So if during this conversation, if you feel like I mischaracterize anything you say, or you feel like I don't understand the point that you're talking about, feel free to stop me. Like you can stop me in the middle of a sentence to clarify or whatever so that I don't run off on some tangent that's not
Okay,
related, okay?
understood. Same goes for you.
Okay. So
Please.
for the most part, I think we're on the same page here. We both believe in that environments are like highly influential on a person's behavior, right?
Correct, yes.
Sure. So I guess then my question is, in terms of my conversation with Sargon, what exactly did I say that you disagreed with?
Just the whole topic about like the STEM fields. That is it's a very competitive area of study to get into. It's from the beginning. I mean, even to get into the universities and into the establishments that you would want to with whatever specific field it is you choose. But just to get into that, get in there and start doing research and with your experiments, if you're in science or technology, whatever it may be. Just to get in it, it is unbelievably challenging and difficult, regardless if you're male or female. I do think men have more of a drive to do those types of things. Really, just because of that's just the stereotype when it comes to men. There is a reason that those traits are associated with men. They have a little bit more drive to create and be innovative and like focus solely on the one thing that they are passionate about. Where when it comes to women going into those specific fields, they're the ones who do get in and make these absolutely just astounding discoveries when it comes to science and technology. They are astonishing women. At the same time, they are not the same kind of woman that like I am. They have more of the masculine traits than you would see like in my field. I mean, because I'm a makeup artist. I am completely feminine, totally girly, so I completely fit in with the feminine thing when it comes to being a female. But if you notice any of those women, the majority of the women that are in the STEM fields, they're not going to be the ones that are going to be concerned a lot with the things that I would be, like with makeup and skincare and hair and just overall beauty. Now, they may have their own, but they could care less about that, those frivolous things. I mean, it is of no concern to them, but they seem to carry more of the traits of what a man would when it comes to they on average, they don't have children because they are completely concentrated on their work. And in those fields, you have to have that kind of a mindset to just be concentrated on that one thing that you choose, because it's usually pretty important research and study that they're doing. So to have children or to have a marriage or to have some sort of family that's going to need that devotion and attention from you, you're not going to be able to give it to them the way that they need or deserve or desire, because you're going to be wrapped up in your work. Now, most women can we can step back and look at that and go, yeah, that would be a tough thing to get into. And that's fine. That's completely fine. I have no problem with saying I could not do that.
Sure,
There's
so.
no way. So when women there's less women in that field because it's harder.
Sure.
It's harder to pull yourself away from like the family unit, because most women go into it as soon as they come out of high school, they go into university, and then they're a student for upwards of 10 years, and then it just keeps going after that. So their education and schooling never really stops. So when they're in their younger years, they're like, yes, I'm going to go to university to become a doctor, specialize in, let's say, oncology or something. And it's super labor intensive, and they're totally with it in their early 20s, mid 20s. They hit their 30s, and they're like, oh, geez. And that's whenever you'll start to see them kind of pulling back a little bit and going into like private practice or only specialized physicians' offices. Maybe if they're doing oncology or something, maybe they'll hook up with a plastic surgeon or a dermatologist and do something that's smaller. They'll scale back, so they're not going to be contributing like long-term research because they're going to pull back. It gets harder because women, they like to have a partner, whether it be male or female. They want to have that connection. They eventually want to have children. It's just ingrained in us. But there is that small percentage of women who they don't care about that. That's not what they're about. They're about the studies and furthering mankind or humankind, however you're supposed to say it nowadays.
Sure.
But so, I mean, I can see that difference, and I consider myself to be a pretty headstrong woman, and I know myself, and I know my limitations, and I know my strengths, and I'm okay with it, admitting to what those weaknesses and stuff are. And it really gets under my skin whenever I hear other people talking about these women, that they need the extra push or they need the extra encouragement and stuff like that. And I don't disagree with you there. There are females out there that they do need that extra encouragement. But on a whole, I don't know what kind of women you've come into contact with, but most women are pretty headstrong. They're pretty strong when it comes to being control freaks, and they pretty much know their own mind. So if they're not in the STEM fields, it's because they've chosen not to be. If they've chosen to go into the beauty industry like I have, that's because they've chosen to. I don't know.
So here are a couple of questions I guess I have for you.
Okay.
Firstly, you're citing a biological, some sort of intrinsic difference between the ways that a man's mind and a woman's mind work, right?
Yes.
Sure.
Yes.
So to some extent, I agree with that. I'm not going to argue and tell you that men think in exactly the same ways that women do. I think mm-hmm. that even in a perfect world, you would see some difference in the distribution of men and women into different fields. I won't argue against that. I think that's realistic.
Yeah.
So here's kind of a question, though. If you go back 40 or 50 years, are you aware that today the representation of women across physical sciences, medicine, you know, research, you know, chemistry, biology, all of these different fields has grown incredibly, right? From 5% up to 45% in some cases, right? Or
yes.
Across legal sciences, right?
Yeah, I'm aware of that, yeah.
So it seems like if you go back, you know, 50 years ago to the 60s, you had a lot of women that didn't have that support in society to drive them to work towards these kinds of sciences, because it was just kind of assumed that if you're working at these things, you're a man, and only men can do these things, and women just aren't capable of doing these things. But
I don't disagree with that. Yeah.
So then.
Yeah, that was going on. Mm-hmm.
If you believe that, and you also believe that, and you believe that to a large extent we're a product of our environment, what's so wrong about sending a message to everybody that anybody is capable of performing well in these fields?
Well, it's really... See, now when you say something like that, that gets my hackles up, because that's just... You're infantilizing women when you say that. I mean, you don't think that we know we have the option to choose whatever the hell we want to choose to do?
No, I don't think so, not really. I don't think that anybody does. So this is something that we kind of...
What? You're serious. You think there's people, like there's a big majority of females in the U.S. that don't know they have options to choose what they want to do? Now, if you're talking about like pressures from their family to do the same thing that they did, I can see that happening, because I came from a highly religious and highly... patriarchal family, because it was religious, so all religions are pretty much patriarchal, and except for the few here and there. But I did come from a seriously oppressive environment myself, but I pulled myself out of that, and I educated myself, and I buried myself in books. I refused to settle for anything other than what I wanted. Now, I had pressures coming from me at all sides, at all times. And this is even before they knew that I didn't believe in God. So once they found out that I was not religious, it became even more unbearable. But whenever you say that people don't know, people do know. And if they say they don't know and they live in the Western world, like they live in the U.S., if they say that they don't know that they have options as a woman to choose what they want to do, they are lying. They are being dishonest, because the amount of media that is put out in favor of women being strong, being independent, I mean, even the deodorant commercials are getting involved. I seen a feminist deodorant commercial. The girl was talking to herself in the mirror and being very abrasive to her own reflection, like that's how she's going to speak to her boss. Women don't speak to their bosses like that in real life. You be polite. You show manners. And if you need to push it a little bit further, then you get HR involved. You don't walk up all hofty on somebody. You're acting like a little girl when you behave like that. And that's not acceptable in the real world.
Sure.
If I had any one of my employees speak to me like that, whether they were male or female, they would immediately need to take a step back and realize that, no, that is not how we conduct ourselves in civil society. It's just not. So when you tell me that somebody in the Western world, in the U.S. specifically, or North America specifically, females do not know that they don't have the option to choose which way their life is going to go or which field, which career they're going to choose, I'm going to have to call you on that one, man. I really am.
Sure. So let me see if I understand entirely what you're saying, okay?
Okay.
So you believe that women choose which fields they want to go into, that the options are presented to them and that they have every capacity to make a choice about what field they want to go to. And to treat somebody like they're incapable of making that choice would be infantilizing them?
Yeah, I think you are definitely underestimating women.
Gotcha. So I understand that. Okay, so if that's a fair characterization of that point. So this is kind of my question then. I'm having trouble reconciling because I'm trying to reconcile your views on agency and free will with these statements. Mm-hmm. Because it seemed like earlier we agreed that people largely are a product of their environment. People largely respond to external stimuli, the environment, right? And then they will make decisions based on biology and previous influences. And that's kind of how they come to make these decisions, right? So I feel like we'd agreed on that originally, but now it seems like you're talking about this idea of women having some free will that is metaphysical, that comes from some other realm. I'm having trouble
These are just basic personal preferences. I mean,
but where do these preferences come from?
Let me see. I'll speak from my own experience.
Well, let's speak generally. Like generally,
but I can't speak generally when it comes to people's specific choices, like their preferences, because I don't know what those specific choices and preferences are.
But we can,
I can only speak from mine.
Like, for instance, somebody that's growing up in some tribe, like with that lives in a third world country, no access to technology, is probably not growing up to become a software engineer, right? If they don't have access to computers. Or, you know, somebody, somebody growing up in an African country with a bunch of, you know, like black, dark skinned people probably isn't doing anything with makeup, right? Because it just wouldn't be something, right? So largely like our preference.
No, that's not true because tribes, that's where cosmetics and makeup.
Okay, that might have been a bad example.
That's where it started from.
Okay, that might have been. I don't know anything about that.
Stepping out of your area, my dear. Stepping out of your area.
But largely, we can agree that like the choice. So how about somebody growing up in an environment that is very poor and has never played video games probably isn't going to grow up to be like a professional video game player or working with games or something like that, right? We largely are a product of our environments for the most part, right? I feel like we agreed on that in the beginning, but now it seems like you're saying that go ahead.
I'm talking about the Western world, that female mentality. I'm not talking about like someone in a specific town or a specific city. I'm talking about like females in the U.S. know that they have choices. Now, if you want to break it down into the smaller groups, you get into the religious sects, you get into the super culty sects, or just it usually comes back down to religion. You'll have families that tell specific genders or specific age groups of kids certain things.
So then we can agree that if a woman
they would discourage them, but only for the reasons of their religion.
Yeah, so we can agree that like a woman that's raised in a very religious family would probably be much less likely to opt for some sort of STEM field, right?
I don't know. I would have to specifically look at that.
Isn't that kind of the argument that you just kind of made? That a religious family that's oppressive to women could raise, or how about, you know, like in a Muslim family, right? So I know we like to make fun of Muslims all the time, right? A woman that wears a hijab her whole life and is told that she's like a servant to a man or whatever, these people would probably be less likely to pursue like a scientific field of study versus...
It just depends on what part of the Muslim world that they come from.
Well, sure, but we can agree that it has more to do then with the Muslim world they come from than like women all deciding to make a choice that, you know, society has never really told them is an okay choice to make, right?
I can kind of see where you're going with that, but I'm not talking about the Muslim world. I'm talking about the Western world.
Well, yeah, but I'm talking all I'm trying to say is that all of us are kind of like an amalgamation of our influences from culture and society, right? When
Yes, I'll agree with you that. I think it's about 50% nurture versus 50% nature, really. And then, I mean, you have all kinds of influences and stuff that are coming out, but I really, really do not agree that there is that big... that there is that oppressive of an influence in the United States against females right now.
Right now, there's probably not. I think for the most part in the educated world, we're hitting these like 50-50 marks or sometimes even greater for women.
Yeah, females, they're, I think, they outnumber men 2-1 in university right now, maybe?
That sounds a little bit high, but I think I have seen that there are more women in university right now than men. I think
or maybe it's because they're graduating more than men are from university.
Yeah, maybe.
It's one that I'd have to pull the numbers up.
Sure.
I wasn't prepared for this conversation.
No, that's fine. I guess just basically the thing that I have trouble dealing with sometimes is that even in talking to you, you seem to agree with me and most a-religious people that there isn't very much like free choice. We don't have like this divine soul that we can draw information from to make decisions. That for the most part, the decisions we make are largely a product of our environment. And usually what I'm arguing for when I'm talking to people like Sargon is I want to create the best possible environment for people to make the choices that will make them happy. So that means avoiding the discouragement of as many people as possible, right?
Why can't we encourage everyone to get into the STEM fields? Because the STEM fields is beneficial to everyone. So who cares if there's more men than there is women? I mean, you're still going to get all the research and science from those.
Well, yeah,
that you would. But I mean, it just seems like women are just being propped up or held up a little bit more than men are right now, when men contribute just as much, if not more, than women do.
Well,
and I know that is going to be a hell of a statement.
For all of human history, men have obviously contributed way more to science than women have, right? But for a long time, women haven't had any representation
in
science
at all,
right?
But is it because they're more intelligent, or is it because they had more opportunities than women for such a period of time?
I would argue that the opportunity was probably very important, right?
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah, so we agree. So,
but the opportunity is there in the Western, in the U.S., in the Western world, for women to take advantage of, and I just don't buy into it that they don't know that they have choices.
Sure,
how many people do you, in the U.S. do you know that do not have access to the internet? I mean, really, because if they go to school, they have to get on. I have three daughters, so. I know that each one of them, and they're all in different, one's in high school, one's in junior high, and one's in elementary. So each one of them, they're studying different things, but they're on the internet every single day in school. So, and their teachers are always pushing them to look at things outside the box. And I mean, they're not being oppressed. They're just their minds are not being oppressed in school like most people think.
Well,
now they're being
polluted,
but not oppressed.
I think that most people agree with that now, that women's representation across most fields is much, much, much better today than it was 40 or 50 years ago. I think that people are just, it seems like a lot of people push back on that for some reason when we've made so much progress, and I think people want to kind of keep that progress kind of equal, and then we kind of look for it in other areas as well. So, for instance,
As long as it's the woman's choice. I mean,
I would hate
to get into something that serious of a career and it not be. I mean, like Asian families, they push their kids like really, really hard, and their families and their legacies have been very, very successful. But they push their kids majorly when it comes to education, and it shows. But is that what that kid really wanted to do, or are they just doing it to Is it their passion, or do they feel it's their duty? Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, I definitely understand it. I don't think you should be forcing people into any particular career.
But don't you think that what you say is putting a lot of pressure on women that maybe do subscribe to, like, feminism and stuff like that? They're like, oh, God, I need to go do this because feminism says I need to and I need to assert myself. And then they get in there and they're in over their head and they flunk out or they fail. Don't you think that's detrimental?
No, I don't really think that's the fairest characterization of feminism. I understand that that's the way that it's portrayed sometimes, but if a woman wants to stay at home and raise children and be a homemaker or whatever, I think that's totally fine as well. I mean, that's a job with all of its own complications and difficulties and everything, right?
Oh, yes, it is.
Yeah, of course. I just think that it's really important. At least what I feel like most people on my end argue is that we should remove as much dissuasion as possible from society, and then let things happen as they may, right? So as we're reaching these big parities in universities where you see the representation of women growing across all of these disciplines, I mean, I think we both agree that that's probably a really good thing, right?
As long as it's some sort, if it's contributing something to society that's helpful.
Yeah,
and not
sure.
harmful, then yes, of course.
Yeah.
But it's let me ask you. So do you categorize or identify yourself as a feminist?
Honestly, I don't even like the word anymore because people have such a crazy idea of what it means, but
Okay, so you're pretty much in that camp. Okay. I have a question for you. Uh-huh. Do you think that male and females in the Western world are still not equal?
Not in all ways. I think that we are at a greater level of equality than we've ever been, but there are still some issues. But I think we're doing pretty good today, sure.
So which one would that be that kind of pulls on your heart the most? Like, which one of those inequalities would that be?
Well, for me personally, it would be like mm-hmm. media and gaming, because that's where my career is, right? Is playing video games and getting an audience.
Oh, okay.
Doing that. So,
fantastic.
This is something that, like, I would point to where in universities and even in some workplaces, not in all workplaces, we're getting a lot of better representation of women. But in mm-hmm. things like media, there are still, like, a lot of stereotypes and tropes that women kind of fall into where they aren't really given very many alternatives, although you've seen kind of a pushback on that recently. Right, would you agree that up until, like, 10, 15, 20 years ago, it was pretty rare to see, like, female lead characters in movies? It was typically always men, and then the only women in the movies would be kind of romantic interests, right?
10, 15 years ago?
Yeah.
Well, it just depends on which genre that you're choosing. I mean,
well, aside from the only, like, big representation I can think of would be Aliens, where you had Sigourney Weaver or an alien.
Oh, yes, she did fantastic. But she was super masculine in that.
Well, I don't know if
she,
I would
so
say that.
She wasn't representing, like, femininity women. She was representing the masculine women.
I'm really
and
curious.
And that's fine.
I'm really curious. In terms of what you say, though, this is really interesting to me. Why would you say that she is masculine in those movies?
She is ripped, and she is killing the hell out of aliens, and that movie terrified me, and she was, like, my hero in, because I seen Alien 1 and 2, I think. I'm not, like, super nerdy when it comes to movies and games and stuff. I mean, I know enough, mm-hmm. but I don't know enough to be relevant. But, no, she was like, a hero in those movies, and she was muscled up and just kicking ass and super short hair and minimal to no makeup. Alien and Predator were actually two of the main reasons that I got into makeup artistry, because I specialize in special effects makeup.
Oh, cool.
So, but yeah, she came across as a super badass. I mean, if you tell me, if she had been wearing a pink polka-dotted 50s era dress while doing that, would it have been as good of a movie?
Probably not. But, like, this is a really important thing, right? So, mm-hmm. This is one of the unfortunate things that I noticed coming out of, like, 50s, 60s, 70s, like, this kind of mentality that when you talk about masculine versus feminine traits, and, you know, stop me if this is unfair, but it kind of sounds like you're saying that, like, masculine is strong and kicking ass and being powerful and being ripped, and feminine is being weak and not able to accomplish as much and not able to do as much.
That is absolutely not what I'm saying, and you know that is not what I'm saying. Do not put words in my mouth.
Okay,
no, I'm
not trying to, but, like, when you say, like, Sigourney Weaver was ripped and she was killing all the aliens and all that, like, why is that something that only a man, why is that masculine? Why can't a woman do that?
it's the majority of the time when you see something like that, it is going to be masculine. Because I don't know, I mean, besides Ronda Rousey, I don't know too many badasses in real life that could, like, manhandle a man.
Sure, but
without it being in a movie. But I'm just saying, masculinity, I'm going to be drawn to, like, masculine features and traits in either the female sex or the male sex, because that's what I'm attracted to. So even though she's a female presenting those traits, I'm still attracted to that character because she's a super badass. And men and masculine traits, I'm attracted to it sexually. So it's going to kind of tie in. It's like it's the personal preference thing that comes around. But you don't see that too often. And whenever you do see it, it's like, oh, my God, that's awesome. I'm speaking from my younger years when I watched it when I was younger. Mm-hmm. But, no, I absolutely do not think women are weak. I think women are weaker than men. I mean, that's obvious.
Sure, but it's not like Sigourney Weaver was like, she wasn't like lifting weights or something that like needed like actual like physical strength.
No, but she was doing all kinds of physical running and fighting for her life and jumping.
Yeah, but like women can do that, right? Women can jump and be athletic. The Olympics, right? Women do that stuff all the time, no?
They absolutely do. I didn't say they couldn't.
So like, I guess I don't see, I guess, so this would bother me if I was I'm going to speak a little bit out of turn, but like if I was a younger woman and I wanted mm-hmm. to get into some kind of physically related field, or if I wanted to do MMA or UFC or something like that, or some very athletic field, that to hear somebody say that, you know, Sigourney Weaver was very masculine because she was a hero and she, you know, kicked a lot of ass, I feel like that's a little bit, that's kind of sad, right? Like, why do those have to be features tied to men? Why can't women embody that as well?
Because that's reality.
Well, but didn't we kind of agree that reality?
Have you ever looked at like one of the serious like bodybuilder weightlifting women their breasts are like gone and they have like pectoral muscles and they have like an 8-pack and just you could see every sinew and crease in their body. Now we could both agree that their body looks spectacular, like that is an amazing form. Now, whether it's beautiful to you or beautiful to me is completely subjective, but that's a very toned and well-defined form. Is it attractive?
So,
no.
Probably not, but you're talking about a very, very extreme. If you're talking about the women that are cutting down to like less than like 12% body fat or whatever, these are like the extreme lifters. Like you can have women that are very strong, like are squatting like 225.
Yeah, that's just athletic.
But even powerful women, like more than athletic, like can move a lot of weight. They don't look like super masculine or super, like they still look very voluptuous. They can still carry some body fat and have nice breasts and booties.
Okay, let me tell you something right now. I am 105 pounds. I am 5'3", and the max I can lift is about 75 pounds without harming myself because I'm smaller framed. There's no way I'm ever going to be able to sling weights and stuff like that around simply because my body is just not built for that. Now, I can do things within my capability. That's where most women kind of get a little bit deluded and think that they can do the same kind of things when it comes to strength as men can, because you can't. I mean, you just can't, unless you go in with the steroids or the testosterone stuff, and juice yourself up to be like a super duper athlete, which some of those athletes in the Olympics, the female athletes, they do it. And they do it because if they put more testosterone in their body, then they're going to have more power. So, I mean, those two things do coincide, but I'm not saying I have an athletic build. I mean, I'm super petite. Everything on me is small, slim. I have a dancer's body. So I can't say, I don't have big hips. I don't have big, big voluptuous breasts. So I wouldn't fit the classic stereotype for a curvy, luscious woman. So that's why I got into the makeup stuff, because you've got to work with what you've got. And for women to think that they can be men, it's just like, no.
Well, again, like when you say can be men, like what do you mean by that? Like,
you can still be athletic and still be feminine.
Of course, but you can also be strong and feminine. Like Ronda Rousey, it was your example earlier. She looks fine. I don't think she looks ugly, and she
is beautiful. She's beautiful to me. She's beautiful, but she is physically strong, mentally strong, and she's ridiculously intelligent and bright, but she is completely against feminism. Well, because she thinks it's detrimental. So,
I'm regardless of Ronda Rousey's personal views, but here's a picture. Like, this is somebody that is stronger than probably 99.9% of men on the planet. Very strong, very powerful. Can obviously.
Oh God, she's not that strong. She's just a woman who trains her body to maximize its complete ability whenever she fights.
Yeah,
so she does have strength, but she has stamina. She has grit, determination, and all that stuff. So whenever you're saying women are strong, are you talking physically? Are you talking mentally? Are you talking
anything physically, mentally, or heroically, mm-hmm. or whatever? Like, she was a world-class UFC fighter. Like,
mm-hmm. Women can absolutely do all those things. And I think that there's plenty of women, female role models out there to demonstrate that. I mean, even with Sigourney Weaver, she's, when she did that movie, I mean, she's not representing a lifestyle, but she's just representing a character in a movie. So,
yeah, but like, what I'm saying is that it's really sad, I think, when you associate power and strength as a masculine trait. So like, there's no way that a woman can be strong without representing masculine traits. Like, that just seems kind of sad to me.
Well, men usually are the stronger of the two sexes. Women usually are the prettier and the softer of the two sexes. I'm totally not saying that women can't be strong and still be womanlike or feminine. I'm totally not saying that. I'm just saying that it's refreshing to see a woman on screen in a hero mode, but it was badass that she wasn't like the pretty hero behind the counter or whatever. She was out there getting like physical and stuff, killing aliens. So it was refreshing. It was refreshing. G.I. Jane, that wasn't the greatest movie, but she's another example.
Or like the woman from Kill Bill, right? If you've ever
she was a psychopath.
Sure, but still like a strong, powerful female protagonist doing something that you typically, right? I guess my only argument is that having more figures like this in society would be cool because maybe it would inspire women that otherwise, right? Like 100 years ago, you wouldn't have seen like women's UFC or women's MMA, right? You wouldn't have seen women doing these kinds of things 100 years, or even bodybuilding or powerlifting or whatever, right? But nowadays you do see it, which is cool. So these women that do it today, had they existed in a society, you know, even 50 years ago, would have probably been discouraged from going that path, right? Because people would say that, oh, well, getting strong and building muscles, those are masculine things. You don't want to do that as a female. Those aren't very feminine things, you know?
Okay, well, the language that we use today compared to what we used back then, I mean, you've got to be honest. I mean, there's definitions for words that have changed over like the last 4 or 5 years.
Sure.
So definitions of and meanings of words, they're constantly in flux. But whenever I say strong or masculine, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with describing someone as masculine?
I guess like the problem is that usually the flip side is then assumed for the other gender. So like, and this might be unfair to say, but like if somebody is very strong, right? They're very physically powerful. And then you say something like, wow, that physical power, that's a very masculine trait. Then it sounds like, or it feels like the trade-off then is that if you're feminine, you should be weaker, right?
No, that's not what that means. That means that's reality. You see a man, you associate physical strength to a male.
But we can have women that are physically strong as well, right? We have more today than we ever had at any point in, you know, human history, probably, right?
Yes, because they have access to more drugs where they can.
Well, not necessarily. Women can become very strong without having to use drugs. Women can become very strong.
Yeah, the physical strength that you're trying to compare with male strength, like female strength with male strength, like physical, it's going to be two totally different things no matter what.
Yeah, it will be, but like an untrained man is not very strong. Like a trained woman.
It's going to be very rare as well.
Sure, but a trained woman who's spent many years in the gym is always going to be stronger than an untrained man, right? You understand that, right? Or do you agree with that? Or
Yeah.
So I guess why can't strength be a gender neutral trait? Like, I could understand some things being gender specific, like facial hair, right?
Does it have to be gender neutral? Why can't it just be attributes that can be associated with both types?
Because
I'm strong for different reasons, completely different reasons than say my husband is. So whenever somebody, if somebody was to say, oh my God, your husband's so strong, I wouldn't think that they're talking about his mental status. I would think that they're talking about his physical strength.
Sure.
Now, if you were to say the same thing to my husband, he would think, like, character-wise or mentally. He wouldn't think physically, because that's just the way it goes. That's just logical language skills, just basic comprehension. When you start twisting things around, that's when things get convoluted and just foggy, and that's when people start to get confused, and then little girls go, ah, should I be a boy, should I be a girl, and then they shave their head and start taking testosterone.
Well, sure, but that's kind of what we're looking at. Like, I don't want a girl to think that, hey, I want to grow up and kick ass and be really strong and be a doctor or a lawyer, and think that, well, in order to do that, I need to be a man, right? I don't want those associations to be
made. You know what, I have three little girls, and one's 14, one is 11, and one is 9. Uh-huh. And I tell them, figure out what it is that you're going to love to do for the rest of your life, for your career or for your job. Just make sure that you love it and that you are passionate about it. Make sure that you are a very kind person as much as you possibly can be, for as long as you can be. Try to set an example that others would want to follow, whether they be male or female. Set examples that you would want others to follow. And treat people how you would want to be treated. I mean, it's just basic humanity. But I never tell them like my middle daughter, she came to me a couple years ago and she said that she wanted to be an archaeologist. And I said, okay, that sounds fantastic. Because she was really like into looking at fossils, because we lived in Florida. So there's always like the sandstone fossils and stuff laying around. So she was really interested in that. And then I told her, I was like, okay. I said, well, what do you know about archaeology? She's like, well, that means I would get to find new fossils that maybe somebody else hasn't found. And I said, okay. I said, well, do you know where you have to go to find these fossils? And she's like, yeah. And this is when she was much younger. So she was using basics. And she's like, yeah, it's usually where there's big mountains or maybe in caves or... oh, yeah, definitely where there's sand. Well, there's lots of sand, so probably the desert. And I'm like, okay. I said, so you're going to need to make sure that you keep your physical health good. So you need to make sure that you eat properly so your muscles stay good and strong and your immune system's good. Because when you go and do those type of expeditions, and then I had to explain what an expedition was. And so once I explained that, she was like, oh, my gosh, that's a lot. Because she's just thinking that she could just hop in a car and go jump and go find a big pile of sand and dig around until she found some bones. So then we started watching some documentaries, like from PBS or Nova is our favorite. And then she got to see, like, they have to carry their own stuff out to these sites where, and they may not find something, they may find something. And living in Florida, you deal with the heat pretty much 9 months out of the year. So she knows what heat is about. And I was like, okay, Kira, if you can go outside and sit outside just in the shade. This was during the summertime. So if you could sit in the shade for 30 minutes and just sit there and build a sandcastle, then I think you could probably do the archaeology thing. I think it would not be a problem for you.
Sure. So now, something like that.
Well, being her mother, I know that she is super whiny when she gets hot. She was out there maybe 10 minutes. She came back in. She's like, nope. Unless I'm doing it in Antarctica, I'm not doing it. It's too hot. I can't deal with the heat. But she still loves fossils. But I gave her the opportunity to kind of feel her way around and make those decisions without telling her this is going to be really hard. Just kind of like let her figure it out on her own, make those mistakes or just kind of feel her way. But you have to be realistic with people.
I understand that. So in terms of, like, earlier you said that we were just kind of like mismatching and mixing up words and arguing semantics, but like 50 or 60 years ago, when if you had a girl that wanted to be an archaeologist or some sort of scientist, people would say that, like, intelligence is a very masculine trait, that to be smart and intelligent is something that's usually meant for men. And you see,
yeah, because they were super misogynistic back then.
Yeah, but even today, like, now you're telling me today that, like, it's so if your daughter wants to be intelligent or any of your three daughters want to be intelligent, that's an incredibly positive thing to you, right? that you wouldn't consider, they're not exhibiting like a masculine trait of intelligence by being
intelligent,
right?
No, they are, and science has proven this, that they are exhibiting their mother's intelligent traits, so.
Yeah, so that's awesome. I think that's a really good thing. But I only argue that you should be able to argue for other things as well, like physical strength can be something that a female can exhibit if she wants to go and train for it, or being the protagonist in a movie that kills aliens and climbs up ladders and runs a lot.
But I've never said that a female couldn't do those things. I'm just saying it's not a trait that's usually associated with women, because it's the majority of the time is a male trait.
Sure, but again, the reason why it's a male trait is because so many people in society treat it that way, right?
Like, no, because it is. I mean, you could lift more than I could. Why is that? Is it because you're stronger than me, or is it because you're bigger than me, or is it because you're male, or is it because you have more testosterone? Sure. No, so, it's just a male trait. You're stronger than I am.
Yeah, but if I would have tried to lift more than or fight Ronda Rousey or any woman in the UFC or MMA, all of them would annihilate me in a single hit, right?
Yeah, it's because they're professionally trained in that. Yeah.
Well, even any woman with any amount of training would probably kill me in a fight. And any woman with any amount of like professional or even like semi-professional or college-level fighting training or high school-level fighting training
but
would probably...
if you went into training and trained the exact same way that they do, you would be able to kick their ass.
Yeah, probably.
No, that's not probably. That's the truth. Because you're male.
Yeah,
I
don't disagree. I'm just saying that I don't think that the strength thing should necessarily be tied into just a particular gender. Like, men on average will be stronger than women, but I don't think that's a good...
You don't like reality then.
Well, no, it's... Well,
I get what you're saying. It's associated with a specific sex.
The problem is that 60 years ago...
Or a specific gender. But it's not gonna affect... women the same way that it did 50 years ago.
But the problem is 50 or 60 years ago, somebody would have said the same thing to you about your daughters. Like, oh, you want your daughter to be really intelligent? Like, that's just not a woman thing. You don't like reality. Like, women just aren't meant to be smart.
Okay, but that doesn't happen now. And that's sexist as hell.
Sure, and I agree with that, and now it
doesn't. And it's completely frowned upon by society as a whole. I mean, as a whole, society, if somebody heard you say that, I mean, if my dad heard someone say that about his granddaughters, because he has three granddaughters now, which he has a completely different perspective on females now that I'm a grown woman. The oppressive stuff and the religious stuff is backed off quite a bit. I think that just comes with age. He's calmed down. But
sure, but maybe you get something.
He would correct them immediately, and he comes from that old school. So he would correct them immediately. So I don't think this is some sort of a trend that's like anything that you've got to worry about it rearing its ugly head again.
Sure, I agree with that. Maybe we get into a point, though. Imagine 50 or 60 years from now when women are told that you can be powerful like men. Maybe not as powerful, but you can still be athletic
and everything. They are being told that they can be just as strong as men.
But not necessarily.
Do you think that women could do the same jobs that men could do?
Yeah, for sure. For the most part, yeah, I think so. There are a few exceptions. Yeah, I think so.
Then why don't you see very many women in the construction industry? Because my family, they build houses and like big in like industrial type structures for people to
here's an equivalent
do businesses and stuff in. But they don't have. I think they've only ever had maybe two females that have decided to go and do that, because it's a really hard job. It's like super labor intensive. Now, one of my best friends, she was a roofer. She was a roofer for 25 years, and it wrecked her body, but she loved doing it because she liked
it. Well, I mean,
it
wrecks everybody's body doing it. Men can't.
Yeah, but it really wrecks women's bodies.
It really wrecks men's bodies. Like,
I know it does. I know it's hell. Bending over like that kind of physical labor is hell. But women's bodies just are not meant to take that kind of physical labor. That's why men have majority always been like the physical laborers when it comes to slaves, and women have always been like the sexual part of it, or the housekeepers or something like that. I mean, it just comes down to basic physiology.
So, like, look at video games right now. Why do men play video games so much more than women?
Because men... I play video games, but I don't play, like, the video games that I think that you do.
Sure. So it seems like there's some social pressure here that we can agree exists, right?
Social pressure? From video games?
Why do you think that men have like a 90%, 95% representation in video games versus women with 5 or 10?
So you're talking about like the main characters, the
No, I'm talking
protagonist.
about people that play video games.
Oh, I don't know. I really don't know. Maybe girls just aren't interested in doing it.
Well, but I mean, like 50 or 60 years ago, people would have said maybe women just aren't interested in being smart, right? But that's
Well, you
changed.
need to ask. You need to ask women then. You need to ask them, why the hell aren't you doing gaming? Do you have fun doing gaming?
Yeah, I do.
I would imagine that you do because it's like your thing. I'm guessing. I've scrolled through your content catalog real quick, and I see all the gamer stuff going on.
Sure.
But I mean, you enjoy doing that, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so if women enjoy doing it as well, I've seen quite a few female gamers and stuff like on YouTube,
Yeah, but
like some of the
it's not
stream
even
channels stuff.
close. It's not even close to how many video games men play.
Okay, well that's women's fault if
Well,
they
but
don't
what
want
I'm
to do
saying is
if they don't
maybe
want to
that's
do
a
that.
societal thing as well, right?
Do
Because
you think that there's something standing in the way of women getting involved with gaming?
I think that in general, men were encouraged more to do it growing up than women were. Video games were marketed towards men, computers were marketed towards men. These were all marketed as being masculine things. Kind of an echo of.
I played video games with my brother a lot.
Yeah,
Remember
but.
the Mortal Kombat? I loved that game.
Sure.
This is gonna age me a lot.
Sure.
But I had no problem, but he would sit in there for hours and I would do it for like an hour and I was like, okay, I'm out. I'm done. I mean, but I loved doing it, but I wasn't obsessed with it or super into it like a hobby like he was.
Sure, but I'm just saying that, like, we can see that, like, video games don't require you to have, like, a physical strength here, right? Like, video games don't require any form of athleticism in terms of, like, lifting weights or, you know, any type of physical conditioning or anything, right? So, what if this is an area that still has a grossly disproportionate number of men than women, couldn't you say that this is probably an area where there's a lot of societal pressure, pushing women away from this kind of field?
Pushing them away from gaming?
Yeah, like maybe there aren't any female protagonists in games, or not anywhere near as many as there are male protagonists, or maybe all of the marketing is like kind of towards little boys rather than boys and girls.
Well, I think it's targeted towards more towards little boys because little boys tend to like it more than little girls.
Well,
I
but.
mean, I have three little girls and I've only ever bought them like the DS games, and the games that they asked for were always Tinkerbell or Disney related or Angry Birds, stuff like that. Now, my nephew, he wanted like the Halo game and Call of Duty and all of that stuff, which those games are fantastic. The graphics and stuff on those games are unbelievable. But then whenever his dad bought a game for my girls, he bought it's like the it's not the Wii. It's the I'm an idiot when it comes to gaming, man. It's the other one where you like put your arm out and it's the console senses your
Yeah,
motions
I
and
think that's
stuff.
the way, yeah.
Well, you don't hold the little thing in your hand on this one.
Oh, is it like a Kinect from the Xbox or something, maybe? I don't know.
Xbox. There you go. So he bought that game for his house because my girls, if those the Halo games and Call of Duty, it scared them because the loud noises, all the blood, all that stuff. They didn't like it, so they bought this game. It's like
Sure.
you're going through like an obstacle course. You're hopping up and down. You're going through rapids and stuff like that, and they loved that.
Yeah.
So,
I guess like if I look at like my own life when I was growing up, I remember that I had a lot of guy friends and a lot of girlfriends growing up, or friends that were girls in high school and whatnot, right? And I knew like a lot of these girls personally, like they would come, you know, we would be playing games in high school and whatnot, and sometimes they would drop by, and that every time, you know, we would talk to them, like, hey, like why don't you play games or whatever? A lot of these girls would literally say things like, my dad didn't buy me a console because he thought that games were for boys, like so we didn't play this kind of stuff growing up, right? Like I heard that kind of talk a lot from girls. Don't you think that these would be people that probably as they get older, not only would they not play games, but then maybe they wouldn't buy games for their kids because they kind of grew up thinking that, you know, women are.
I think that they would probably buy games for their kids. I mean, because that's just the cultural norm at this point is like video gaming.
Well, yeah,
I mean,
but
even my parents know about it. But
it's
I
hitting a
see
point
what
when
you're
I.
saying. I see what you're saying. And sure, there are those people out there that they do still hold those kinds of thing, those sexist outlook on boys and girls. But you're usually going to find those in like the really conservative, like close-knit type
Sure, but
areas.
it used to be way more common across most of the US than it is today, right? Like,
Those types of views?
Yeah,
with
that, like, people
boys versus girls?
Yeah, that people wouldn't buy girls' consoles. Like, I know growing up, I knew a lot of girls who wanted to have consoles, and they'd have to go over to boys' houses to play the consoles, and the parents didn't even like that, but their parents just wouldn't buy them gaming systems because they didn't think that that was the kind of thing.
I wonder why. Well, maybe it was because of the games that were available. They weren't like girly stuff, and maybe the parents didn't think that it was appropriate for their kids to be playing like Mortal Kombat.
But that's what I mean. Like,
I know my
Mortal
parents
Kombat
didn't have a problem with me doing it.
Why
but,
does Mortal Kombat have to be a girly game, or why can't that be a girl and boy game? Why does it have to be for only boys?
There's girl characters in Mortal Kombat.
Yeah,
it's just more violent. It's just bloody.
Yeah,
girls don't like bloody. We just don't like violence.
You guys deal with blood on more than men do,
but
right?
But that's not violent, and it's not pleasant.
I mean,
believe
some
me, we don't
can be
like
violent.
It. We don't like it.
And women give birth. Women have to deal with more blood loss and trauma in their average life than a guy. You've had three children, right?
I did not look at it once. I did not look once when I was giving birth, and I gave birth naturally all three times. I didn't want to see that shit. That's gruesome.
Yeah, but so you've dealt with even more. So no epidural or anything?
Oh, hell yeah, I had drugs. Are you kidding me?
Oh, I thought you... Oh, okay, I'm sorry, I missed it.
No, I'm talking about I didn't have a C-section.
Oh, okay,
gotcha. That's like the norm now. No, they were born vaginally. But sure. No, I didn't look. I didn't want to see that.
Sure, but I mean, you still went through it, so it's...
You can't tell me that you... Okay, you put a panel of people up. You put two men and two women in a room, and you put a video in front of them, and you turn on, like, an ISIS beheading or something. Those women are going to make an audible noise, and they are going to flinch and turn away from it. Those men are going to go, holy shit, and not break eye contact with the screen.
But that's not necessarily true. I had, when I grew up, this is going to sound really weird, but there were two girls that I knew that went to another high school, and these girls were really into, this is going to sound really strange, I have strange friends in high school, but they were into like watching like gore videos and stuff online. They're actually, they would send me links of like really weird stuff.
Dude, what? Where the hell did you grow up?
I'm in Nebraska, so maybe we're a little
bit
weird.
No wonder
here.
You don't have anything to do. No wonder y'all are watching crazy shit on the internet.
But I'm saying
no
that, like,
wonder you're a gamer. You were bored.
But I'm saying
you didn't want to be a farmer, so now you're a gamer.
But I'm just saying that if you put these girls in a room with two guys that maybe grew up in like San Francisco, right? Like these girls would probably be more likely to say like, oh yeah, violence, that's cool or whatever. I'll play Mortal Kombat than maybe the more sensitive guys, right?
I'm sure that's a possibility, yeah.
So like we can see that like in these ways society can influence people. Right, in order to look at things like violence doesn't necessarily have to be intrinsic.
But don't you think that like advertisers and stuff that they follow trends? They do like studies. They put kids in rooms with toys, and they watch to see where the kids go towards the toys or which ones they pick organically to play with, and they pay attention to this kind of stuff.
But also that could be damaging sometimes.
There's science behind it.
Well, but that can also be like a self-fulfilling prophecy too. I knew a girl that oh my god, I think she actually competed. I don't think it was in the Olympics, but in an Olympic qualifier. This girl, the only reason that she went into the Olympics or was doing Olympic level athleticism, I think I don't remember if she was a swimmer or what, but she did it because she watched Kill Bill, because she thought that the Kill Bill movies were so cool, and that was like one of the things that at an early age inspired her to like take it really, really seriously, right? Like,
well, that's fantastic.
So
yeah.
Like, had this movie not existed because advertisers say that only men, you know, only men like to do these kinds of things, she might have never gone into it, right? So what I'm saying is that if you have these people in society like showing that, hey, women can kick ass, women can be violent or do whatever that men can do, that more women would be more likely to think that way.
Yeah, I mean, of course, yeah. I mean, if you have more figures in society representing certain ideals or certain traits, then yeah, you're going to have people out in the real world that are fans of it and want to emulate it or inspires them. But I mean, I think we have that covered. We can always add more, of course, but I really don't think it's...
Yeah, no,
like
I agree for the most part. I don't think that it's like a horrible, like women are horribly super oppressed or anything. I don't agree with that. Some people might say that, and that's crazy. But I think like, I think like the adding more, because like I wonder sometimes, you know, if you're a girl growing up and you only watch, you know, video games or, you know, men in movies doing cool things, maybe if you had more female role models, you might be more likely to go into that as well. You know, like it doesn't have to be all men doing everything, but females or women can do these kinds of things as well. You know?
Okay, well, here's a question for you. Do you not think that men can set an example for females to want to emulate or replicate? And I'm not talking about like gender traits or sex traits or anything like that, but just say you have a man that's very successful, and then a little girl sees how successful he is and is inspired by maybe like how he got started and then how he became successful, like inspired by his life stories.
No, I don't. In general, I think that when we look to people to be inspired to, I think that usually people that look like us and are kind of representative of us, I think are is a really big deal. That's why when you go to
it's a little bit more influential. Yeah. I'll give you that.
Like
yeah.
when you go to
yeah,
the Olympics, like people always root for their team, you know, because these are their people, their country, like their countrymen and whatnot, you know?
Do you want to hear something funny?
Sure.
Two of my favorite makeup artists are men.
Sure.
One is female. So it's those two male makeup artists are the ones that inspired me to become a makeup artist. And then once I finally figured out, okay, this is what I want to do, then I found the female side of makeup artistry.
Sure.
So I'm a little bit of an enigma myself.
Yeah, I can understand, and everybody can be a little bit different. But like I knew, I used to know there was a girl growing up that I knew that really wanted to go into a medical training. And she was a really big fan. Have you ever seen the show House?
Yes.
And she
absolutely
was,
awesome.
When she was growing up, she had always told us in high school that she wanted to be a doctor. She wanted to go to med school to be a doctor. But because she had watched House so much, and the lead doctor House there kind of took the reins and everything, she eventually changed her major and moved into doing nursing because she didn't really feel like, you know, like she could take that leadership role, because in all of the like Grey's Anatomy and in House, it was always kind of the men in the lead doctor position. And I think she was probably smart enough to do it. But then she ended up not going into it because she said that, like, well, if you look at, you know, how doctors are today and, you know, everywhere, it seems like these guys are, you know, more or less the leaders and whatnot. And as a woman, I would feel uncomfortable kind of leading in these scenarios. And I feel like maybe if you had like a show where there was a doctor lead that was a female, maybe she would have thought a little bit differently and did the whole push to be a doctor and go to med school, you know?
Well,
I'm not arguing that, like, again, like, I'm not saying that women are super ultra oppressed or anything. I just think like having these different kind of like points of view represented in media, I think is like kind of positive for everybody, you know?
Yeah, well, I don't disagree with you on that. Okay, so let me pick your brain when it comes to the gaming stuff. So just from someone who is, I'm not involved in gaming whatsoever. I mean, I can't tell you the last time I played like a game other than Candy Crush or something like that. But just seeing it like on YouTube, seeing the streams and stuff, the females that are involved, why do they all have their tits hanging out?
I mean, that's it gets into like really complicated things, but I mean, the easiest way for women to advertise themselves in this realm is probably to appeal sexually to
boobs.
Guys. Yeah, boobs, yeah, for sure. Yeah. Boobs. Yeah, boobs and booties. Unfortunately, though, like growing up, it seems like there weren't as many females playing games as guys. So you're going to see way more men in this arena than females, right? So if you have way more men here than women, what kind of women are going to do the best, right? The ones that probably appeal sexually to men sometimes?
All right. I get that. Well, look, because the community that I run with when it comes to YouTube, it's going to be the skeptic community. I'm an anti-theist. I'm a super big fan of AIU. I'm a super big fan of Sargon, Andy Worski, all those guys. If they're not making me laugh, then they're making me think. But I'm sure you've noticed there's not very many females in this
community. Yeah, in the skeptic community.
There's just not. So I have to fight tooth and nail to be taken seriously, and I have to fight tooth and nail to be able to keep up with it, because it is a boys club. It absolutely is, because it is hard. It is really difficult, because if you are taken seriously, then it's automatically assumed that you're some sort of like screeching harpy feminist. It's like, okay, she can't be secular, or she can't be an anti-theist unless she's some sort of SJW, like just some sort of crazy. So I have to break back past that barrier before I can even get into the conversation. Like, I have to get past all the sexual stuff. I have to get past all just like the hazing and the raising and all that good stuff.
And imagine for the skeptic community.
I am fine with that. The problem I have is my sisters who will not swallow their pride and just get into this, because I need all the backup I can get.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that most people are like that. And I don't think it's because women lack choice or lack agency, but like if the skeptic community has...
No, they don't lack choice or agency. Yeah. They lack the backbone.
Yeah. Well, or
because once they do get into it, the first time they are criticized, mm-hmm. like I'm sure you have a pretty big audience. I think I've seen you had like 50,000 subs or something like that.
Yeah, something
and like you that. Have quite a few followers on Twitter. So I'm sure I'm going to get some sort of response from the people who enjoy you, and I'm not going to take that personally. I'm not going to hold you personally responsible for that.
Sure.
Because I'm coming on here on my own free will, putting my opinions and things and my concerns out there with you. Mm-hmm. But I am going to get some sort of backlash, and I expect it. This is social media.
Sure, but all I'm saying is that, like, if the skeptic community had like 4 or 5
most
large
women can't women, handle that.
Well, I'm just
most
saying
women can't handle.
Well, I don't think men could either. If you went into a community that was majority women and tried to like break into that, it would be very awkward and very strange. If all the viewers were women and all the people there were women, that would be very strange as a guy to break into that, I think. But like if the skeptic community had, you know, 50-50 women, you know, versus just all men and like no women, I think it would be easier to break into. It's really funny that you bring this up because I actually had a friend. She was a YouTuber and she had built her channel up to about 35,000 subs, and she mm-hmm. wanted to get into the skeptic community. But when she tried to make videos, I think she was talking about, oh man, I think she was making it was criticisms of Obama at the time. I think this was back in 2014 or 2013.
Oh gracious, she was playing with fire.
Yeah, she was. But when she started to make her videos, all of the people in the comment section were saying things like, show us your tits, like blah, 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 right? Like, and then when she went, the crazy thing was, and this was the response that she got, and eventually she dropped it entirely because she just didn't want to deal with it. She didn't think it was worth it. That when she looked into the analytics of her YouTube channel, she like noticed it, like, you know, I'm kind of wondering, 98% of my viewership is male. I wonder if there were more women watching, if I would have had kind of a different breakdown on how viewers reacted, you know?
Yeah, that's probably so.
Kind of like, because like if I'm a man going into the skeptic community, everybody has their own challenges, but that's something that I'll never have to face. You know, I'm never going to go into.
Nope.
Yeah, I'm not.
Nope.
Gonna,
you definitely will not. But I don't hold that against you.
Yeah. No. I'm not telling you to hold it against me. I'm just saying that like I recognize those challenges, and it would be cool mm-hmm. if there was more representation. So you know, there weren't so many barriers. You know, up
yeah,
for people.
Yeah, and that's I do have a few sisters out there that are on board with it. They are completely in with the game. They understand it. They get it. They can go with the flow.
Sure.
But they're also very intelligent.
Yeah, sure.
So we're kind of working our little pinky toes in, but YouTube is just, it's cancerous. It is, sure. The comment sections are absolutely cancerous. So my normal comments, because I normally just do like podcasts, uh-huh. And do streams and have conversations like I am with you right now with
sure.
all different types of people. But my comments, I have to get past the bullshit first. Like they'll
sure.
try to set me off with some sort of a personal attack.
Yeah, like
first.
Why aren't you in the kitchen cooking instead of on YouTube or stupid shit like that, right?
No, it's usually whore or I'll rape you to death or something like that, because people don't like to hear a woman speaking out against religion.
Sure.
It literally, I hate using the word, okay, I won't use it. It sets them off.
It triggers something in their head.
Yeah, it triggers something in their head where they're just like, ah! But if I go in and I say something to them and I'm like, okay, are you done now? What's your gripe with me?
Uh-huh.
Then they'll engage. But a normal woman wouldn't do that. She would just go up, delete, block, you're done.
Sure. Or a normal guy too. Like a lot of guys will pick something up, get frustrated with it and put it down, right? Although, because it's not like men are all these like multi-discipline, like can play multiple instruments, speak multiple languages, you know, do all of it. Like a lot of guys will pick something up, get frustrated and put it down immediately too, you know?
I feel like
for the most part, I think we kind of agree, right? I'm not arguing for like a massive reform of society, but just having more women in certain places, I think is nice to give more encouragement, you know, for women to go into these fields, right?
I think maybe you might see it a little bit differently than I do. I think that we probably agree that yes, it is a good idea to have more women role models and representatives
mm-hmm.
for little girls, but they need it. It needs to be the right kind. Holy
sure.
Jesus, it needs to be the right kind. But when it, like, let's say with your specific topic, like with gaming, yeah, I'd like to see more females in it. But I don't think that the gaming stuff needs to change to encourage women in. Maybe get the game developers in there
mm-hmm.
to maybe, I don't know. But see, I don't know that much about women in gaming. I don't know if they gravitate more towards like the Halo stuff that I was talking about earlier, like the more violent stuff, or if they gravitate more towards, I guess, like the epic video games, like where you have a purpose, you're trying to get to an end goal, or I don't know, because see, I'm not all that up to date on it. I'm not that educated on it, but I think maybe is there not male game developers that are trying to appeal to women?
Yeah, they are now more than they were before. But I mean, again, like video games have been, this has been
so the past, I guess the market's kind of presented itself a little bit more.
Yeah, but it's starting to change. More women are getting involved in games now, but they weren't, you know, when I was growing up, and I'm sure probably not when you were growing up, right?
I honestly don't know. I didn't pay attention to it when I was growing up, really. I didn't think about that kind of stuff when I was growing up, really.
Sure.
But no, you've piqued my interest on that. I'll have to look into it a little bit more.
Sure.
But yeah, I definitely, the skeptic community, we seriously need to get some more females in here.
Okay, sure.
Yeah, definitely need to get some more females in there, so. Okay, well, it was nice talking to you and picking your brain a little bit. I'll have to come back and talk to you again. I've taken down a few notes of some of the things that you said,
mm-hmm.
and I'll look into it
myself,
and,
I'm
and try to get a little bit, because I'm just trying to understand your line of thinking just a little bit better. I mean, and I know you cover a whole range of topics,
nice
but
more people stopped
I'm doing it a little bit at a time, and I'll check out your content a little bit more as well. But
sure. Basically, all I'm really arguing is that it would be nice to have more representation in some industries, just so that other people can kind of aspire to it, you know?
Okay. Well, I think that there is, I don't think there's as much female representation in it as what you would like,
uh-huh.
but I think there is sufficient female
It's better than it was like 20 or 30 years ago, right? Yeah, of course.
There's definitely role models out there for little girls that they can go, hey, she's pretty cool, I think so. Wee, let's do that.
Sure.
There are those people out there. But, yeah, To a degree, I agree with you.
Okay, cool.
And to a degree, you disagree with me. So we'll agree to disagree on a few little finer points. But
sure.
Okay. Well, I'll check it out. But Steven's your real name, or do you go by Steve?
Steven. Steve's my dad's name.
Okay. Well, it was nice to talk to you. Thanks for letting me come and chit-chat with you. I'm Kari, by the way.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, Kari. I appreciate the conversation.
All right. I'll talk to you later.
Yeah, have a good one. I don't even know if I feel good about this one. Is this worth it?